Hello again, everyone. Mark Hackle, Macomb County Executive. John Paul Rea, our Deputy Executive, just giving you an update on what's going on with the COVID issues here in Macomb County. And where are we at with today's numbers?
Mark, the updated numbers from our community dashboard this morning, over 4,700 cases countywide, unfortunately 483 deaths. When we take these numbers out statewide, just under 34,000 cases statewide and over 2,800 deaths. Again, increases across the board statewide, not only in Southeast Michigan with concentration, but outstate we're starting to see some other spikes. Kent County, Kalamazoo County. Governor coming out yesterday saying they're going to be looking at this, not only with their epidemiologists, Department of Health and Human Services, going to still need to look at the numbers over the last week of the stay-at-home order and see what our next steps are going to be.
Yeah, and a sad reality, when you stop and think about it, we know it's like every day we give this report, the numbers keep climbing. I mean, and you stop and think about it, you kind of said that, you know, as difficult as it is, people are dying as a result of this. And so we have 483 deaths today. We know at some point in time we're going to be doing this and updating people, and there'll be over 500 people that have died as a result of this coronavirus. So, you know, it's a sad reality, and thus the reason why we still have this stay-at-home order and people trying to, you know, self-isolate and kind of keep themselves at a distance. So it's a challenge. And now the new twist is, I'm hearing in the news, you know, a while back we heard, you know, that some of the big cats at the Bronx Zoo had tested positive for this coronavirus. Now there's news that apparently there have been a couple of domestic cats, household cats, separate incidents that have gotten this, gotten a positive test for the COVID virus in New York as well. And apparently they got it from their pet owners. I mean, it's amazing where we're headed with this. At first they didn't think it could happen. Now there's a belief that, you know, even pets now are susceptible to this.
Mark, it seems each day we're learning a new piece of information that's not only going to help us to respond to where the virus is going, but it's also going to challenge us where we're at with resource allocation at this time. Obviously, getting a better understanding of how it's going to impact those that need to engage the medical field, whether those that are going to the primary care physicians are going to try to weather the storm through self-quarantine, but unfortunately those that have to engage our healthcare system, whether it's critical care, whether it's those that need more long-term care, these are things that we're going to have to juggle day in, day out, not only with our healthcare providers, but what it also looks like, as we discussed first yesterday, with those influx of new resources that we're getting from the feds from some of these stimulus and package bills, and how we can get those around to the community.
And that's going to be a question people are going to ask, you know, okay, so now I'm hearing that my pet could possibly catch this, this virus. Well, what do I do? How do I handle it if they're showing signs? They're not recommending that you're going and getting your pets tested. Now they're saying that now there's an obvious indication that they can get the actual coronavirus. The question is, they don't believe still that they can transfer it or that they can pass it on. But who knows, that may change too in a short period of time. It's just kind of a sad reality that we're now seeing that's kind of impacting animals in our homes as a result. So just kind of one of those things that you gotta deal with. Also interesting is I get a lot of questions from folks saying, hey, you know what, I'm tired of just staying home. I wanna just, I'm gonna start my, my business back up. And whatever that business might be, I hear it from people. Some people are emailing us, some people call me, I go to a store or a restaurant, and some people are saying, I'm getting tired of it. You know what, I don't think law enforcement's gonna do anything about it anyways. I might just open it up. We just want to caution people. I mean, these are issues that here in the state, when you got a state health order in play and an executive order in play, law enforcement locally can enforce that. You also got the state police that can come involved. The attorney general can get involved in this, and Health and Human Services can get involved in this. So, whether you think that your local law enforcement may just turn a blind eye or not want to do something, don't be misled into believe that somebody's going to make that call and say, hey, they're not abiding by this executive order. And I say that because even recently we just had an incident in Shelby Township where some business decided to lure people in under the premise of giving them some kind of a COVID test, and then we're doing some non-essential services, kind of medical services. So the feds just raided that particular facility in Shelby Township. So you want to caution people. I wouldn't get ahead of this. I think I'd let the process play itself out, and if those orders are in place, you're going to unfortunately have to abide by them.
Mark, aside from the calls that we're getting with regards to combating the virus and understanding how it's impacting the healthcare field and obviously what we're doing for emergency response, the calls from businesses have been the second highest volume that we fielded. Whether it's here at our EOC, whether it's the different call centers and call banks, whether we're directing people to the governor's constituent line. Again, take heed with those orders, what they're currently in place. Those safeguards will help us defend ourselves against the spread of this virus. And also, as we continue to work with our federal and state partners, we'll begin to clarify of how we're going to start opening things back up, what that means for local small businesses here, and what other outlets are out there. Again, Macomb Business, where you can get through the macombgov.org portal. Macombgov.org is the place to go to get all those information of how this is impacting your businesses and what resources are available out there.
Yeah, extremely robust website we have available, all the information you need. And again, all of it is vetted and factual based information. We see the tensions. We know people are getting upset. Weather isn't very conducive to help with people that are at home wanting to get their kids out and playing. That's been a bit of a challenge, but you know, we're believing that you're going to start to see some movement. Even just listening to some of the press conferences on behalf of the governor, you know, I got to believe at some point in time there's going to be a progression into that. So, you know, the frustration level is there. Mm-hmm. We're starting to see it, but people are just going to have to be somewhat patient. In the meantime, while people are at home, there's a bit of good news. I mean, Macomb County, Michigan, tends to be doing rather well with people complying with this, understanding why we need to fill out that census. Census 2020, bring back the money. I want to remind people how important that is for funding, especially with the crises we're seeing right now. It was important back before this crisis, but funding for schools, funding for roads, funding for, you know, community support that we have. Extremely important to fill out those census. And here in Macomb County is number two in the state with folks that are actually responding to those census. We want to be number one, so if you get that census, trust that information is guarded. It's not going to go anywhere. You can believe that that will be addressed if somebody does violate that on behalf of the Attorney General. But being number two in the state is pretty compelling.
I think it's something to be proud of. Obviously, we want to reach for that number one, but when we look at the state of Michigan, number five nationally, it gives us an opportunity to illustrate what's our voice going to be here. So not only they hear us in the halls of DC, they hear us in the halls of Lansing, and we understand what our needs and our priorities are and how we get those necessary resources back here to Macomb County.
Yeah, we dipped a little bit. Early on, we were actually number two. We were tied for number two in the country. Michigan was, but now we've kind of fell back to number five. So it's not Macomb County's fault being number two in the state. Obviously, we're doing our part. But again, I think we can even do a little bit more, get people to respond to that. And we're doing some things very creative with Macomb Community Action with the food resources, getting some people the necessary foods. I mean, Macomb Community Action, the schools are doing an incredible job right now of providing food to those that really are in need of it. I seen it firsthand the other day, and I know there's an attempt to try to get people to come on down and get the food and remind them of the census. Macomb Community Action was just doing something with that the other day, and I think it was even reported on in the Macomb Daily.
Been a lot of interesting outreach, not only with regards to the congregative dining options that were given to seniors and those with more need-based food services that we're continuing to keep operational to serve everyone around the county that has any food security issues, whether it's children, with the partnerships with IMSD in our local districts, and also with regards to our senior food options and our local food pantries. But getting more creative, our team has developed some of these drive-through lanes where you can come in, you get a meal in partnership with the community and a local restaurant and everything. Celebrated one in down in Center line with Rising Star Academies. We got another one that's going to be happening over in Utica with our friends over at Jimmy John's Field and the United Shore Professional Baseball League. All that information is available at macombgov.org. We're going to be doing around the community, getting people information not only about our services, but how you can get your census information out there and really showcase that Macomb County is a place where we're coming together as a community.
And again, I refer people back to our, you know, macombgov.org. I mean, everything and anything you can imagine is available on that. Even talking about how do you link to getting a better understanding of what the census is all about. If there's food needs that you have, where those, I guess that information is at and available as well as our statistical information. I do want to remind people, if you look behind us here, it's interesting. That's that Rite Aid that opened up and provided opportunities for people to get tested for this COVID virus. It seems to be doing rather well. And what I want to remind people is if you need to get tested, you're looking to get tested, there are plenty of opportunities, and that information is available at macombgov.org as well. Click on the icon. They will tell you whether you have a primary health physician that can help assess you and send you someplace or not. We have locations available, and that happens to be one of those, and it's doing rather well. So on that note, we just want to once again thank you for tuning in and continue to keep you and your family safe and healthy.